Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Dan Fonte, has written a memoir. But it's more than a memoir. It is a gutsy book that captures his father, who was the famous writer John Fonte. And the book is entitled, How a Family's Legacy of Writing, Drinking, and Surviving. And it's published by Harper Perennial. Welcome, Dan.
Thank you for having me on your show,
Connie. Well, thank you for writing this book, 400 pages, but also the fact you have put both pictures of the family that almost like a filmic sense goes through as you're reading, and at the end, you have letters as well as the description of the pictures. But let's talk about growing up in Hollywood. But the Hollywood of the working writer, your father.
But my dad was a contract screenwriter, and he worked from the time he was about 22 years old. He worked 40 years in the Hollywood film business, off and on, through the Hollywood 10 and through the studio, the birth of the studio system, He made his living at that, and only at the end of his life was he really notorious as a novelist.
What were some of the films he worked on?
He did a film with Jane Fonda and Barbara Stanwyck called A Walk on the Wild Side.
Uh-huh.
He did a film with, his most successful film was a film called Full of Life, with Judy Holliday and Richard Conte.
But you know, it's interesting, you said Walk on the Wild Side, Nelson Algren.
Of course.
And in many ways, it was as if he was similar to Nelson in,
it's an interesting
in the rage,
observation.
In the way he lived and wrote.
Yeah, it's an interesting observation. And by the way, it was a difficult film to make because the producer, Charles Feldman, was sleeping with the star, and he made my father rewrite the script to put the emphasis on the star, who was a woman named Cappuccine at the time.
Oh, very
My
famous.
Father hated Charles Feldman.
That, you know, that's Hollywood.
Yeah,
and
sure.
That's what happens that makes a lot of screenwriters go crazy.
Yeah.
Now, your father had a great passion. He was also a drinker. He was also a gambler.
Yeah.
He had an eye for the ladies, and yet he adored your mother, Joyce.
Yeah, he would have had that kind of Italian sensibility. The woman was to stay home and raise the kids and cook dinner, and the man was to go out and do whatever he wanted to do. And somehow, I don't know how, but somehow that worked. It didn't work when I was a young boy and my older brother, when we were young, because my father was very much the man about town. But later on, it began to work, and when my parents began to have an accommodation in their relationship.
And of course, I just should say that at the end, your father with diabetes was at the motion picture home.
Correct.
And people don't know that this was a place for people who were in the industry, film industry, to have a place where they were taken care of.
Yeah, he was well taken care of there. But I'll tell you a funny anecdote. When I was wheeling him in, he was blind, and I was dropping him off that day, and I said, "Hey, Pop, you're going into the Harry Warner wing." He said, "Oh, Jesus, take me home."
Yeah.
He did not like the war. There were very few Hollywood producers that my father was enamored of.
But as a child growing up there, there were you and your older brother, who was pretty tough on you, going to a parochial school where they also beat you.
Yeah. Well, that was corporal punishment. I got punched every once in a while, but that was the way it was done in those days. And I got a decent education, but my dad was he was educated by the Jesuits, and so he wanted me to have a Catholic education as
well. Well, the Jesuits were one thing; other
Different. Yeah, that's the SWAT team of the Catholic Church.
But by the time you're a teenager, you're working on, anybody who comes to California, Santa Monica Pier.
Yeah.
At, as a really a carny, pulling them in, learning to not take no for an answer that works for you later in life.
Yes, yes. Yeah. No is just a request for more information.
Isn't Connie. That a wonderful expression?
But it was actually Pacific Ocean Park Pier, which was which is now gone, as you know, in Santa Monica. But I had a great time there.
Yeah. And it's interesting because it plays back at the end. You have a friend there that you used to go to a motel and just watch TV.
Yeah, yeah. We would smoke pot and, you know, and bring girls there. But we, when I was in Santa Monica College, his uncle owned a motel or managed a motel. And so we'd cut school and we'd take girls back there and smoke pot and like that.
Because I have to say later, when you are, for another time, getting yourself dry, detox, you are so desperate and you're sure there are cameras and things around, you go into the air conditioning
duct.
And discover...
This is very strange experience. I was trying to sober up. A couple of times, maybe three times in my life, I self-detoxed, which is locking yourself in a motel room and drinking water and shaking it out for days. And I was in this motel room, and I began to see visions, and I was detoxing. So I thought there were people listening, so I removed at one point the air conditioning duct, and in the air conditioning duct I found driver's licenses, baseball cards, and something else, and I pulled them down, and it was shocking because I looked through the driver and it was the same guy. I hadn't seen him in 15 years. It was the same man that I used to hang out with in that motel.
Yeah. You know, we've made everybody who goes to a motel now take down the duct in order to see if something else is in there.
I guess.
But your life takes you to New York City.
Correct, yeah.
And in New York, it's almost like Times Square cowboy. You are there trying to make a living, and it is hand to mouth. There are women, there are men. It is the dregs of the world, to be honest, as I'm reading it.
Well, it was a curious time for me because I was a heavy drinker, and I spent a lot of time roaming the streets in Times Square, and I lived in this strange apartment house in Hell's Kitchen, and where across the street was a 20-foot high alternately pink and green cross. And one side of the cross said, "Sin will find you out," and the other said, "Get right with God." And so this would blast through my window all night long, and I just got tired. So I would go out and roam the streets, you know, and I got myself in a lot of trouble.
In order to earn a living, though, you become a taxi cab driver.
Correct.
And I didn't realize there's a taxi school alumni group in order to get a license.
Well, what they do, which is really curious, they give you a test. It's about 4 or 5 pages of printed material that you study, and you learn locations of buildings, okay? Mm-hmm. So, but I was from Los Angeles, and I hadn't driven a car when I took the taxi test, and so I wound up knowing all these, but not how to get to them. So I remember my first day driving a cab, a guy in the Bronx got in Jerome Avenue and 167th Street, and he said, "Take me to 169th and Girard." I said, "Can you tell me how to get there?" And I did that 1,000 times, and I learned how to be a New York City taxi driver.
Now, in between, you were also an actor,
radio show,
writer. Yeah. How'd you work it all together?
Well, my taxi driver job was my mainstay, and then when I got into the radio and I started directing theater and wrote a radio drama, I would do that after hours. I'd make it a short day, drive until 6 o'clock, and then we would rehearse two or three nights a week, and then we would tape the show. So that's how I did it.
But every one of these...
Drunk on my butt.
You blew it every time. I mean, I kept saying, okay, when's he going to blow it as I'm reading the book?
Well, you know, yeah. The part of the alcoholic temperament is to self-destruct. And, I was a master at it. And it's interesting, you know, people... talk about writers and the passion of authorship and but no writer worth his salt has written anything while intoxicated.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just true in my experience, you know. So
but then there is, what was it, Dave or Rob the limo? Rob Limo?
Dave Coe, yeah.
Well, that was, again, it could have been a movie.
Yeah,
you get involved with him, and he puts you in charge out here in Los Angeles. But there, you could make your tips, you could do things, and there were people, Marvin, I think it was, who hired you for weekends, and you would end up making $1,000 a week.
Oh, I had a wonderful time, especially with the man's name, the name I use is Marv Affernan, which is close to his actual name. But Marv owned a design outfit in New York City, mm-hmm. and he and his partner Frank they dined at the best places and they went to the best. And so I drove them every weekend for a couple of years. And so I met the best designers and architects in New York and ate at the best restaurants. It was wonderful.
Then you are on the street of New York peddling. I probably bought something from you because I love to go with those guys with the things on the floor or on a table.
And was arrested many times, Connie, doing that. But I made a very good living at it, and it was all... it's a cash business, and so you work 2 hours a day. I worked at the base of the Time Life building on 52nd, and so, or was it 50th, and when the secretaries get out, there are 5,000 secretaries, and they bought my hats and baby bracelets, and I would leave after 4 hours work with, you know, a couple hundred bucks a day.
But you didn't keep money around, so when you are arrested and taken to that judge who says, $20 or you spend a day in jail and all you've got is 19.
No, I had probably 200 tickets, enough to paper a wall, and I was brought in front, myself and the other peddlers, there were probably 30 or 40 of us at Christmas time, and there was a big roundup, and they brought us down to the tombs, and then we appeared in front of the judge, and they stacked our tickets on the desk in front of the judge, and he was charging $20 per ticket, $20 or 1 day, and I had the 200 tickets, and somebody turned their back, and I saw my tickets on the table, and I grabbed them all except one, and I walked away paying $20 that day.
But somebody gave you a dollar.
A guy passed me a buck. Yeah. He stuck it in my hand behind me.
Yeah.
And otherwise, I probably would have done, well, I had 200 tickets times 20 days. That's 400. That's a year, over a year in jail I would have done.
Coming back to Los Angeles. Now, in every case, it seems to have been a female, a woman who was involved, who also had her problems.
I have been married and married and married and married, I've had a lot of relationships. I've had hostages too, and it goes both ways, you know. So, but that's before I got sober, and it was I was looking